अस्सलाम वालेकुम, आई एम इंजीनियर हमना शकील। वेलकम टू द सिक्स्थ ऑनलाइन लेक्चर ऑफ CE 117L इंजीनियरिंग मैकेनिक्स लैब। आर टुडेज एक्सपेरिमेंट इज अबाउट फाइंडिंग फोर्सेज इन वेरियस पार्ट्स ऑफ वॉल क्रेन। सो आर टुडेज ऑब्जेक्टिव इज टू ऑब्जर्व हाउ फोर्स दैट इज अप्लाइड ऑन अ वॉल क्रेन इज डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड ओवर इट्स मेंबर्स। बिफोर स्टार्टिंग डिस्कशन ऑन दिस एक्सपेरिमेंट, लेट्स फर्स्ट रिवाइज अ फ्यू कॉन्सेप्ट्स अबाउट एक्सियल लोडिंग। एक्सियल फोर्स इज द वन दैट यू अप्लाई इन द डायरेक्शन ऑफ द एक्सिस ऑफ द मेंबर। This force can be either a tension force or it can be a compression force. So if you apply this force in a way that you're trying to stretch the rod, it means that you're applying a tensile load. If you're trying to apply the load in the direction of the axis of the member in a way that you're trying to compress the member, it means that you're applying a compression load. Let's try to understand what happens inside the member when you either try to stretch it or you try to compress it. Let's start with the tension force. So the tension force is applied in the direction of the member, and this force tries to stretch the member. So if you apply this sort of force on a member, there will be an opposite reaction produced inside the member. So if you represent this member by a straight line with tension force applied on it, you can represent the reaction inside the member by this symbol. So let's see how you can draw a free body diagram of this part of this member. So here is your point. This is the applied tensile force and this is the reaction force, and both will be equal in magnitude. If you draw a free body diagram of this part again, this is the applied force and this is the reaction in the member that is equal to the applied force. So here you can see that no matter which part of the member you take and draw a free body diagram of, the reaction force in the member is shown by an arrow that is pointing in the outward direction. Similarly, if you apply compression force on the member, there will be a reaction produced inside the member in the opposite direction. Right? So let's again represent it by a straight line. So here is your applied compression load, and here is the reaction that is produced inside the member due to the applied load. So let's draw a free body diagram of this part of the member. So here is your member. This is the applied compression load, and here is the reaction force. Similarly, if you draw a free body diagram of this part of the rod, so here is your applied compression load, and this is the reaction. So if you observe this, you'll see that the reaction force to the applied compression load is always drawn by using the arrows that are pointing inwards. So if you draw a free body diagram of a member that is under tension, you can represent the reaction force by using an arrow that is pointing in the outward direction, or you can say that away from the section or away from the joint. Similarly, if your member is under compression, you can represent the reaction force in the member in the free body diagram by using an arrow that is pointing towards the section or towards the joint. So coming back to our today's experiment, that is to find forces in various parts of a wall crane, we'll first understand the mechanism of the wall crane, and we'll make use of law of polygon of forces to find forces in various parts of wall crane, and we'll compare the result from the graphical solution to the experimental readings. So let's see what a crane is. A crane is basically a heavy machinery that is equipped with cables and pulleys, and crane is used to lift or lower the materials during construction. One of the most common uses of cranes is in the construction industry. There are various different types of cranes. A few of them are mentioned here. You can see here on the screen. So you can see here that this one is a mobile crane. This one here is a loader crane. This one is a tower crane. And here you can see an overhead crane. And this crane is installed in Earthquake Engineering Center of our university. Here on the right side of the screen, you can see a wall crane that is installed in Engineering Mechanics Lab of our university. For this experiment, we will be needing this wall crane. We'll be needing certain weights, and we'll be needing a measuring tape to measure the members of the wall crane. Here you have a hook. You can see here on the screen. This hook is used to carry the loads, and in the illustration, you can see a hanger that has the same purpose, that is to carry the loads. So here you can either have a hanger or a hook that is used to carry the loads or take the weights. Here you can see a pulley, and now we understand the mechanism of the pulley because we have discussed this pulley or the mechanism of pulley in various experiments. Here you have two hinge connections. The characteristic of the hinge connection is that it is restrained in horizontal and vertical direction. Like it cannot move in the horizontal or vertical direction, but it is free to rotate. So here you have two hinge connections. Here you have an adjustable connection. That means that if you apply a load here on the hanger, this connection can move upward or downward and can adjust itself according to the weight or the load that is applied at the hanger or on the hook. So here this green line and this red line, these are representing the two members of the crane. This string that is attached at the hanger is passed over the pulley and is connected here on the adjustable connection. Here you can see that this is a hook. The string is passed over the pulley and is connected here to the adjustable connection. So when you apply a load here on the hanger, this string that is attached to the hanger and is passed over the pulley and is connected to this adjustable connection, this string will be stretched, and if it is being stretched, it means that the string is under tension, and the magnitude of the force that is developed in this string will be of the same magnitude as the applied load, because that is the mechanism of the pulley. Whatever load or force you apply here, you'll have the same load developed here in this string. Only the direction of the force will be changed, but the magnitude of the force will remain same. Because of this applied load, this member will also be under tension, as this member will also be stretched, and the magnitude of the tension developed in this member can be measured by reading the spring balance. So if you need to know the magnitude of the force developed in this member, you can simply read the spring balance. If you observe the mechanism of this crane, you'll see that if you apply a load here, this member here will be under compression. This member will be compressed. These two members will be under tension. These two members will be stretched because of the applied load. And this member here, this will be under compression. And there is no spring balance, or there is nothing attached here. So you don't know the magnitude of the compression force that is developed in this member. So the member that is under tension is known as a tie, and the member that is under compression is referred to as a strut. So you have one tie and one strut in your wall crane, and you have one string that is passed over the pulley and is attached to the hanger. Now that we understand the mechanism of the wall crane, we can start with the procedure. First step is to label the members and connections. To start with that, we are calling the tie as our member 1. We are calling the strut as member 2. We are calling this hinge connection of the tie as connection A. We are calling this connection of strut as connection B. This string here is member 3. And the connection of this string is connection number C. This part here is labeled as O. And the hanger where you apply the load is labeled as D. After labeling the members of the wall crane or various parts of the wall crane, read the reading on the spring balance. So it will be showing some reading that is because of the self weight of the members. Call that reading as TI or initial tension or initial reading of the spring balance. After that, measure the lengths of the members using measuring tapes before applying any load on the hanger D. After that, apply some load here on hanger D. After applying load, read the reading on the spring balance again. This time, this reading is because of the self weight and the weight that you have applied here on the hanger. Call this as TF or final tension in this member 1. To find the tension in member 1 that is only because of the weights, subtract initial reading from final reading. This will give you T1, that is tension in member 1 because of the applied load. Again, after applying the load, measure all the members. Measure this AC, measure this CB, measure OB, OC and OA. Record these readings in a table. Plug in the values in this table, the value of applied load, the value of tension in member 1, the measurement or length of OA, OB, OC, AB and CB. These are your experimental values. By using these experimental values, find a graphical solution and find the tension in member 1, compression in member 2 and tension in member 3. So till now we have these values. And to find the graphical solution, let's explore the parts of the wall crane a little further. As discussed earlier, because of this load, this member 3 is under tension, having the same magnitude as that of the applied weight here. Member 1 is also under tension, and this member 2 is under compression. So you can say that this OA or member 1 that is under tension, OB that is member 2, this is under compression, and OC that is member 3, this is under tension and is having the same magnitude as that of the applied load. So we have got the measurement of OA, OB, OC, AB and CB, and we also know the forces that are here in these members. Let's move further. This information of lengths of various parts of the wall crane can be used to draw a space diagram. Space diagram give us the direction of the forces but not the magnitude of the forces. To draw a space diagram, first select a suitable scale and convert the actual lengths of the member of the wall crane to a scaled length to accommodate the space diagram on your sheet. After selecting a suitable scale and after converting the actual lengths of the members to a scaled length of the members, we can start drawing the space diagram of the wall crane. You can start by drawing a vertical line AB and select a point C on the line AB. After that, take your compass and open it equal to AO and draw an arc. Then open your compass equal to OB and draw another arc. You can connect this A point with O, C point with O and B point with O, and then you can draw a vertical line that is representing the part of this string with which the hanger is attached. So this will give you a space diagram. After getting a space diagram, you can represent the forces that are developed in various parts, various members of the wall crane. So member 1 is under tension, so you can represent it by using this symbol. Member 3 is also under tension, you can represent it by the same symbol. And member 2 is under compression, so you can represent it using this symbol. After that, draw a free body diagram of this point O. In a free body diagram, tension is represented by an arrow that is pointing in the outward direction, as we discussed in the start of the lecture. So this is your T1. Member number 3 is also under tension, so it is also represented by an arrow that is pointing in the outward direction. This is your T2. And compression is represented by an arrow that is pointing in the inward direction, and this is your compression in member 3. So here, if you observe this W, compression, tension 1 and tension 2, you can see that these are coplanar and concurrent forces. So if you have coplanar and concurrent forces, it means that you can apply law of polygon of forces on this free body diagram. Before applying law of polygon of forces on this free body diagram, let's see what we know about this system and what we don't know about the system. So we know the magnitude and direction of the applied force. It's acting in the downward direction. We know the magnitude and direction of this tension 2 that is developed in member number 3. So the magnitude of this T2 is equal to the applied load. That is because of the pulley that was attached here on this point O. We know the direction of T1. And we know the direction of the compression force. But we do not know the magnitude of T1, and we don't know the magnitude of compression force. Also note that the system is in equilibrium. So if we draw a polygon of these forces, this polygon shall close. First step is to select a suitable scale and convert the known magnitude of W and T2 into length using the scale, like we did in experiment number 1, experiment number 2 and experiment number 3. After that, apply law of polygon of forces. So let's start with W. Draw a vertical line of length corresponding to the magnitude of W as per your scale. Then take T2 and connect the tail of T2 with the head of W. And the length of this T2 shall correspond to the magnitude of T2 as per your scale. And we know that the magnitude of this W and magnitude of this T2 is same. So the length of W and the length of T2 must also be same as per your scale. After that, take C and connect the tail of C to the head of T2. Here we do not know the magnitude of C. So we do not know how much shall be the length of this C. So you can draw this C of any length. But the direction of this C shall be the same as that in the free body diagram. After that, you have to connect this T1 or the tail of this T1 to the head of this C. But the problem here is that we don't know where this C is ending, because we don't know the magnitude of C. But we do know that our system was in equilibrium and the polygon shall close. So it means that the head of this T1 must be connected to the tail of this W to make a closed polygon. So instead of connecting the tail of this T1 to the head of C1, you can simply take the head of this T2 and connect it with the tail of W. So you can take your T1 and you can connect it with the tail of W. Again here, you don't know the magnitude of T1, so you don't know the length of this line. So draw a line of any length, but the direction must be the same as that in the free body diagram. After that, you can either extend or contract the line C and the line T1 to close your polygon. Once your polygon is closed, you get the length of C, and you can convert this length of C into the magnitude of C by using your scale. Similarly, you get the length of T1, and you can convert this length of T1 into the magnitude of T1 by using your scale. So this will give you the magnitude of T1 and the magnitude of C. Now you have the magnitude of all the forces in all the members of the crane. You can use these values to fill the table. So you can fill here the magnitude of T1, magnitude of T2, and magnitude of. Once you get both experimental and graphical values, you can compare the experimental T1 with the graphical T1. And you can also find the percentage error between the two. So you have to do it for a second time and for a third time, and this will conclude your experiment number 7. So here is your class activity. Use these experimental values to find the graphical solution for T1, T2 and C. The solution of this activity will be uploaded on Google Classroom.